to discuss at all. But through a chain of events, I got more or less drawn into it. There was recently a celebration of 325 years of academic publishing in the Netherlands, one of the oldest printing publishing houses, in which also deals with Arabic. It's a fantastic event with music, speeches, a small exhibition which even featured a modest contribution that we made to this tradition, which was the very first automatic electronic typesetting of bilingual text, a Persian and English dictionary that was the result of the United States-Iran Claims Tribunal in The Hague, which had so much money to discuss that there was plenty of money left to use the latest equipment in the 1980s to set up the dictionary. We merged them into a single bilingual text. So that's also a social event where you have a reception, you meet old friends, and you get introduced to new ones. I got to know Bob Kerr. Bob Kerr asked me later to write a Liber Amicorum, or a Festschrift of Friends book for Professor Witkamp, who is also associated with the Leiden Arabistic establishment. And when I happened to scrutinize his list of publications, I stumbled on a text that reviews an Arabic font specimen book. I suppose it's about type specimens. And it's in a design magazine. So it's a very unusual environment for an academic publication. And it says that the last Dutch letter specimen was produced in 1910. And it actually concluded the Dutch contribution to Arabic typography in the Netherlands. So here's the full text in English. The last Dutch type specimen with Arabic was published in 1910, Oriental Scripts, by the Amsterdam foundry, former Tetterode. There was no more Dutch involvement with Oriental typography since, until very recently. And then the book that he reviews is then the resumption of this Dutch contribution or involvement. Now you can imagine my surprise when I read that, and since it was in a design magazine, I didn't really thought it was important. But on the other hand, it was signed by the author with his full authority as professor of Arabic paleography and codicology. So here you go. A fashion magazine or a design magazine with a professor who states that there is no Dutch contribution since 1910. Now, this reminded me of the keynote speech of the celebration of Brill Publishers, where the chairman of Dutch universities, the Dutch Universities Cooperative, said, well, this may be a kind, peaceful place, but it's actually a boxing ring where the publisher provides the equipment for the fights. And so when I saw this statement, I thought, since I am working in this field, I'm taking up the glove. So here are my thoughts. So what is this 1910 specimen book? And what exactly happened between the Raphaelensius that he mentioned as the beginning of the Dutch involvement and this specimen book that is the termination of Dutch involvement? And by the way, can we be sure that not that there was no involvement after 1910? And what is the book that breaks this silence? Now here it is. It's a catalogue by the Dutch letter, Amsterdam letter foundry. It's not far from where I live. Actually, I live across the canal from there for years without being even aware that it existed. The catalogue is fascinating. It's in 1910. It covers what would be covered today by Unicode, with a focus on East Asian scripts, and that is colonially relevant scripts, like scripts of the Netherlands East Indies, and theologically relevant scripts, like Hebrew, Syriac, Coptic, Greek, Persian, Turkish, and so on, and Arabic. Now, the typefaces, there are actually only two typefaces dealing with Arabic in this book. And a quick inspection, typeface 1, typeface 2, again, typeface one. Typeface two. A quick inspection, in fact, yields to me the conclusion that there's one Arabic typeface and there's a Urabic typeface. And we have to investigate what is Urabic when opposed to Arabic. Well, I'm falling back on linguistic techniques. I'm trying to find distinctive features that give me absolute proof that it's not Arabic. So here I identify a particular way of dealing with the shape, which is frequent in this specimen, and I define it as a Urabism or Urabic feature number one. I've seen that before. Because before starting Decotype as non-typographers, I first spent about a year and a half frequently visiting the Leiden University, where Professor Witkom was the curator of the Oriental Collection, making sure that we were not reinventing the wheel. So all these things have passed my retina, but I refreshed my investigation, prompted by this statement. Urabism number one. Huh, this is where I saw it. This is the Fano, the very first attempt to print Arabic. It has these funny things. That's the Kitab al-Salat al-Sawari, the Horologium Brevi of Venice, 1514. It's meant for the Christian community inside the Islamic world. It was a disaster. The shapes you can find also in very early milestones of the Umayyad Empire. They're dealing with the same glyph with the same formal solution. What it also reminded me of, something I saw in Verfleet's paleotypography of the French Renaissance. Something printed with Jesuit types. And you see, I've blended in an image of the Jesuit typeface in a 300 years later Dutch typeface. There is not a lot of evolution. And they're basically the same constructions that are in close up, like flipped Zs. In real Arabic, these things do not exist. So this is Urabism. They exist in this kind of European typography. I think it doesn't take an Arabic expert to understand that this is mechanized scribblings. You see the Z is there. And it's a Urabic feature. It doesn't exist in Arabic. Then the second weight of the same typeface has a totally different approach to the same glyphs. In fact, this is what my wife doesn't allow me to call, and therefore I call it the inverted V. It's something that the Arabic script tradition deals with all the time in totally different manners. And to deal with these shapes in these stereotyped inverted Vs or tits is something that you would find again in these deranged attempts and any European typography, but nowhere in the Islamic script tradition. So it's a very nice distinctive feature. So now we have instruments to investigate the Dutch role in Arabic typography. The instrument is basically part of a larger picture, which I call script grammar. And let me give you an example of script grammar. In the earliest forms of Arabic, there were stretchable letters, which means that if you stretch them, the letter doesn't become different. Here you have the Kaf and Dal, which have an additional complication that they use the same shapes in those positions where they exclude each other, but if they can coincide in the same position, one shape is made different. And that's the vertical stroke. If you omit the vertical stroke, you're actually creating a stretched form of another letter. So in the green columns, you see two examples of original Islamic manuscript. In the red column, you see a brilliant modern Persian reproduction in the open type format of the same script, but without knowledge of the grammar. And as a result, they inadvertently created a letter del where they intended to write a letter kef. So script grammar is also semantically relevant. If you don't know it, you can make errors. I created a diachronical overview of script evolution in the Arabic or Islamic tradition. on the basis of these distinctive features, and I'm now projecting this inverted Z element in a larger group of paleographic, which are the dark green ones that are discontinued, and the ones that are still in use. The later scripts are all marked by the greenish zone, and the reddish zone are the European attempts to mechanize the script, whereas the blue one is the one that I characterize as classifies autodidact. It stands outside any knowledge of the Arabic or Islamic script edition. These are scholarly solutions in the West, created in a bubble of ignorance of Arabic scripts. For instance, here you have a group of three units that I marked with the letter B. They can serve as the carriers of multiple letters, but if they coincide, they are always made unequal. So whichever phase in the evolution of the Arabic script you find yourself, there you can always see that there's no repetition of the same shape. There's always a slight trick to make them legible. And even the typographical mechanizations, the Middle Eastern one, that is in column 6, which is taken from the Quran, the Cairo Quran, or the Microsoft Arabic typesetting font, they all try to apply this concept, but it's absent in the blue column, which is taken from the Leipzig 1845 Quran, the so-called Flügel Quran. This scholar doesn't know about this. So that's the Arabic feature there. Now you have the larger picture. That this blue area actually expands in modern days in all kinds of modern computer typefaces, including the one in column 12, which is the one that looked very much like columns 1 and 2, but without script grammar. And there is a new column, number 9, which is the omnipresent Arabic Times New Roman, which has the Jesuit approach to these particular letter forms. So it gives you a quick overview of what I mean with script grammar and what it can do for you to understand these things. So we go back to the statement, Oriental scripts, Tata Road in 1910, last Dutch involvement in Arabic scripts. Now, the introduction explains Arabic. The stereotype explanation is Arabic is very complex, it had four forms. Well, this is a good way of knowing that whoever writes that doesn't know how Arabic script works, because it has more than four forms. And indeed, the font is cut under supervision of Professor Taco Rorda in around 1845. Now, who is Professor Taco Rorda? He's not a typographer. He is hardly an Arabist. He's a Protestant vicar, theologian, Hebraist, Arabist, specialist in Netherlands in these languages, and evangelist. So what he did, basically, was to look at what was available and tell the cutter to do something similar. So what is something similar? Well, that is based on what happened before in the Netherlands. And as the article in the Items magazine says, it started in 1595 with the specimen Characterorum Arabicorum by Franciscus Raffalensis. Well, it's a beautiful thing. I took the trouble to drive to Antwerp to see it in the Plantin Moritz Museum. And here we go. They're all there. There is there are the multiple dits, and there is the inverted Z. It's full with Arabisms, and it doesn't connect to any Arabic script condition. And in case you doubt it, there is this overview, the Alphabeticum Arabicum. He gives an introduction of how the Arabic script works. The four forms: initial, middle, final, and isolated. Well, that's a way of saying, I have no clue that there is such a thing as Arabic script grammar. Then there's an introduction. There's a nice facsimile edition of this, done by the Leiden University Library. It's pointed out that the typeface is inspired by Grandjean. Now, Grandjean was a professional, and he looked at manuscripts for clarity. Raffalensis, or Scaliger, which was the teacher of Raffalensis, no doubt acquired a copy of Grandjean's work, and it has a table of initial, middle, medial, final, and unconnected forms. And then here it is. Who could ask for a better example for cutting a copy? So he's cutting a copy on the basis of very flimsy understanding of Arabic script. And at the same time, John Lane, who is not the least in this business, is totally unsuspecting. He thinks that this is a reasonable statement. And I'm challenging that. Geoffrey Roper, on top of that, says that the irony is, of course, that Carnot himself, in the 16th century, designed Arabic fonts, which attempted to imitate Nasr calligraphy with umpteen ligatures. Now, the whole idea that he thinks that you need the ligatures to imitate calligraphy is, again, a sign of ignorance of Arabic script structure. The ligatures are there to reproduce the structure, not the calligraphy. The calligraphy is stands on top of the structure, but it is not the structure. In other words, European scholars do not have this tradition to investigate it. And that's interesting. How do we get there? Now, Franciscus Raffelhengius, or simply Frans van Raffelingen, is basically a scholar of Hebrew letters. And why Hebrew? I mean, we are living in the Netherlands and in the lowlands. In Flanders, we live in the marshlands of the Rhine. And who could get excited by Hebrew? Well, this happens in the 16th century and the 15th century when there was a big polemic between the Roman world with the holy language of Latin, which in turn had a polemic with the Islamic world, mainly the Ottoman world, with as a holy language Arabic. But inside the Roman fortress, there is a nest of dissident fundamentalists who want to go back to the true faith, which is of course not captured in Latin, but in Hebrew, in Hebraica Veritas. The Hebrew documents are the truth. These are just dissident fundamentalists. The word dissident in those days was Protestant. And many of them converged on the Netherlands. In fact, it led to a split because the Dutch rose against the Catholic power. The Catholic power sent the army like the Syrians would do today. They tried to quell it, and the Protestants from Flanders moved to the north of the major rivers in a tactical advantage. I stem from this tradition myself. This is my great-grandfather's Bible. Who gave it to his son-in-law? How do you learn Hebrew if you live in the marshlands of the Rhine? Well, it takes an historical freak accident that in these days it happened that the Catholics recaptured Spain, the Reconquista, which chased the Jews either into the Arabic world, the Islamic world, or into the Protestant areas of England and the Netherlands. And there they are, teaching Hebrew to the dissident Catholics. And to understand in the experience of the Oriental Jews, Arabic and Hebrew were related languages. You have to realize that concepts like historical linguistics and comparative linguistics did not exist, but they sensed that there was a similarity. And they used that to clarify the dead language of their religion, because Hebrew had been dead for about 1500 years by the time they ended in the Netherlands. To give you an example of the usefulness of an auxiliary discipline, to use one language to clarify another one, I have a nice Dutch example. There are crowds in the Netherlands who believe in the word godsvrucht, meaning God's fruit, like fertility, something that enriches your spiritual life. If you realize that Dutch is very close to German, and if you then turn to German and discover that there is a similar word in German that is Gottesfurcht, then you suddenly realize that you're dealing not with fruit, but terror. It is God's fright. So it's a totally different thing. But you can have sermons ranting about the fruit of God in the Netherlands, because they didn't consult the German auxiliary language. Now, in the context of Judaic Arab Jews, they used Arabic when they were dealing with Arabic, but when they wrote about the Old Testament or the Torah, they would use quote in the appropriate script. So you had Arabic as Arabic and Hebrew as Hebrew. And indeed, you can even see that the connectives, like the word and the word the article is still in the Arabic script, whereas the continuing lexeme is in Hebrew. And you can even see here a sequence of words that are being enumerated with the Arabic word and in between, wow, which reminds me of an article by Hassan Murad, who wonders whether the comma is possibly a borrowing from Arabic. And if you just invert the direction in the green example, you can see that he has a point. There's another aspect of Judeo-Arabic that they do. They write Arabic with Hebrew letters because the Hebrew script is not connected with a language but with a religion. So if you're a Muslim, you write with the Islamic script. If you're a Jew, you write with the Jewish script. But there are also exceptions. There are the Karaite Jews who write the Old Testament in Arabic letters. It's also Judeo-Arabic. So what do we have is we can have the Hebrew language with Arabic script, we can have the Arabic language with Hebrew script, which means that Arabic relates to Hebrew like Italic would relate to Gaelic. It's just a font change. And the difference between the fonts is that the Arabic letters are completely integrated, like fusing in architecture, whereas Hebrew letters are completely articulated, they're separate. So you have fusing versus articulation, which is a concept in architecture. And these functions are the difference between presence or absence of grammar. And you see that in the early works, Hebrew is actually advised as a better vehicle for Arabic than Arabic itself. So one of the founding fathers of European Orientalism says, it's better to write it with Hebrew letters, it's easier. Which is a way of saying Islamic writing culture is completely irrelevant. And indeed, here you have a Quran, which by the way is given as an argument in the fight of the Roman Empire, Roman-German Empire, to get victories over the Mohammedans. Study of Arabic, in other words, has a polemic aspect. This is the Quran, where I put an extra column with the form that it should have in the eyes of Muslims. Then you have the founding father of Dutch scholarship and the Oriental studies. That is a Frenchman who moved to the Netherlands, Scaliger, teacher of Avalanches. His handwriting is full with Europisms. But his translation, that's interesting. This is a translation of a laissez-passer into Arabic, where he, for Prince Mauritius, where there is a ts sound in the name, but he writes it with a funny Arabic letter for it, Mauritius, which, if you know the system, the relation between Hebrew and Arabic, it immediately makes it clear that he was thinking of Arabic in terms of Hebrew phonetics. It's like a smoking gun. They were completely focused on Hebrew, and Arabic script was irrelevant. This is a pupil in this tradition. This is Scholius. Jacobus Scholius, great scholar, cannot write Arabic. Here you have Thomas Arpinius, the founding father of Western Arabic typography. He formulates, he standardizes the rules of Europisms in a very clear, explicit text in Latin. He even thinks it's nasch. Here's the word nasqui. He thinks that it's nasq. We have heard discussions here. If you deviate from the rules of a script, it's no longer that script. Well, do they deviate? Here is the Europism again, and it gives some additional rules how to dissimulate, which do not cover Arabic script grammar. He gives advice how to stretch letters, which is based on practice in Hebrew script. So the text, this is a paragraph about text justification using Hebraisms and stretching. And if you realize that this could have looked like Microsoft Word output with Times New Roman Arabic, then you have here a piece of the Quran, which is basically the prototype for modern industrial Arabic. So, but while men like Arpinius were juggling with Arabic, in the Middle East we are in a period that they're at the zenith of perfection of their script. This is Hafez Osman, the founding father of the Ottoman school of Nasr. And Nasr is the model for Arabic typography. In these days, their productions must have looked like another jewel of Dutch typography. It's a fashion magazine that's dedicated to the Arab Spring. They mistranslated it into a jump of Arabic, Hafstad al-Arabiya, instead of Arabiya al-Arabi. They have This is a serious photograph with no context, but as you can see, the letters also have no context and are in the wrong direction. And it's not just in Holland. This is a shot in a tram in Stuttgart. It's a very pretentious quote from Naguib Mahfouz, but all the letters are unconnected. And here you see the greatest scholar of the Middle East and of comparative linguistics, Sir William Jones. He couldn't write it. And it never stops. I will quickly run through this. I had many more intense comments on this. 3 centuries later, we still found this in 1950 in the Netherlands, a book on the Malayan Arabic script, where the man actually copies the 16th century typesetting to teach writing to European scholars, unaware of the real reality of writing in the area that he describes. And this kind of typography is all over Europe in scholarship. In Germany, we have examples in France, we have examples in the Netherlands, of course. And the Germans created their own variation of it, which all, like the Muhammad and Nabi, the Prophet Muhammad in Eurobisms, we have them in Austria. We have the greatest scholar of Germany, Otto Spitaler, a 20th century authority in Arabic, cannot write Arabic. He writes Arabic. And then we have the lady of knowledge of Islamic calligraphy, Annemarie Schimmel. She writes typographisms and has no consistent style in her handwriting. And when she explains a fine point about the confusion that occurs when you take away the dots, she thinks in terms of Arabic script, as if without the dots there would not be a difference between these letters. In other words, she has no idea of script grammar. And we have the final one, I think, Yale University Library, where they have a pretentious Quran quotation, unaware of the script grammar that I pointed out, the difference between a D and a Kaf. So where they thought that they were writing Bismi Rabbika, they write Bismi Zibit, in the name of your Lord becomes the, in the name of butter. And then Alladhi Khalaqa, who created, becomes Alladhi Halwa, who became sweet. So in the name of your Lord who created becomes in the name of the butter of he who became sweet. Here we have a recent book about Arabic calligraphy, the Or of Alif, about script, recently produced, with huge reproduction, enlargement of Arabic script, without any knowledge of the details. They think that there is a bubble here, whereas it's a serif. And then you get a comment, she cast a script, it's difficult to read, developed from one that it's very free, it has rhythm, it's musical, it's like a remembrance of God, and in fact it's the wrong script. It's not Shikesta, it's not free, there are no unauthorized curves, it's not very personal, it's not difficult to read, and it's not a calligraphic trance exercise, it's not secret. It's a meticulously regular Nastaliq exercise. And this is a whole platoon of scholars with double doctorates who signed for this, and none of them have noticed the difference. This is in McGill University, the call for the Friday prayer, Salat al-Zuma. One of them had the good sense to take out the Eurobism, which is, you noted on top, that you do not connect a lamb with a gene like that. Then the Gallographic State, Messick, there is a comment about print culture, where Karsten Niebuhr is quoted, but he forgets to mention that this is the attitude. This is a 17th century traveler who says, the Arabians value chiefly a species of elegance, which consists in their manner of joining the letters, the want of which makes themselves dislike the style in which Arabic books are printed in Europe. It's a difficult way of saying, we can't read it. So they knew, this Messick says, they knew that there is printed material, why aren't they reading it? And in the footnote it says, the answer is there, they couldn't read it. And the Turks were aware of it, and again, there is an observation by a French traveler who says that there is a problem with the liaisons, and which is of course not the gaps, but the script grammar. And then we have complain that when the Ottomans start to print, that it is only scholarly books that they're printing, not religious ones. Well, what's wrong with scholarly books? And of course they do fantastic jobs. Let me quickly move to an end. Here is a new book with a fantastic image of Arabic script about language and culture, and here is the script structure. And there's a beginning and the end, a two- or fourfold structure, and he comments that it's very difficult to write Persian with this script because everything looks the same. And in some cases you can't even break up the words, which he advises, and because it's unavoidable ugliness. Well, of course it's ugly because it's no longer the script. Remember the dissimulation rule? If you apply normal Arabic script, the problem doesn't exist. Did nobody notice? Of course, there's Helmut Ritter, who writes some rules that you have to respect when you print Arabic. And there is the famous Mitchell, who says, the infrequency with which one encounters European scholars having a knowledge of the Arabic script has often been observed. I call that a typical British overstatement. And going back then to this catalogue, the contribution, there's another typeface, and that's not Arabic, but Arabic. And where does that come from? That comes, they announce it as a typeface from 1865. It's from Turkey, when they succeeded in 1866, finally, to produce a typeface that you can use and read. And this is the model of all later Nasks. There's one problem with Tetevoda, they managed to destroy it to the extreme. They took out all the improvements and they flattened it. Why am I so sure that they copied it? Because it's documented by Ovink in the history of Tetevoda, where Enschede complains about copying by Tetevoda, and Tetevoda implies that it's industry practice. and here is what remains of a brilliant design in the hands of Tetevoda. So this is the catalogue, the last contribution by the Dutch, and I can't wait to see the next one a century later. But I think this is all. But one final remark, that there was a small calligraphic example in the introduction quoted by the reviewer, where he doesn't notice that it is not calligraphy at all. It is a deco typeface which destroyed the grammar, because otherwise we couldn't get it into Microsoft's template. And it's done by Mamoun Sakal, who uses a typeface, so he's a typographer and not a calligrapher. You see the same initial form, where the real Zulu script would have a different one in each case. And so that more or less concludes my talk, with one comment, that there is announced that the Netherlands will be dedicated to the role of Dutch and Flemish typography in the Arab world, for which it provided book and type design until the end of the 19th century, which is completely untrue. In fact, the role of Dutch Arabic typography in Middle Eastern printing is very modest indeed. That's all.